amen. Say amen again. God is good all the time, and all the time the Lord is good. We've been talking about coaching for success in life. Can you say amen? Amen. Living life at its best, living life at its highest, the tools and principles that it takes in order to accomplish that. Can you say amen? Amen. You don't have an outline, they certainly want to hand you one. Amen. Simple principles extracted from the text. Amen. That allow us to understand how God can get the best out of all of us. Come on, say amen. Certainly, I want God to get the best out of me. I'm not an easy project. Can you say amen? Amen. He really needs to lay his hands on me. Come on, say amen. Other folk know what I'm talking about here. Amen. Don't just touch me one time. Touch me again and again and again. Every morning, I'm looking for new mercies in my life. Can you say amen? Amen. God is good. I just like to look upon your face because I recognize we may never be like this again. It's only by the grace of God that we are here. Amen. And we have to make the best out of it. Can you say amen? Amen. Now, you know, there are a lot of good things that are coming up in the church. I certainly want us to reach out and touch all those who are part of the family. Amen. To make sure that they are a part of all the goodies. Amen. Amen. That the Lord is going to be doing here at Southeast Community Church. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. So let's be a part of God's business the right way. Come on, say amen. 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 So here we are. I want to look at a passage in the book of Luke, chapter 9. Amen. Starting at verse 57, Jesus' conversation with three disciples, three followers, or three would-be followers, more hermeneutically correct, potential followers. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. Now it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to him, "Lord, I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere or no place to lay his head." Then he said to another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God." And another also said, "Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house." Jesus said to him, this verse always sticks with me, "No one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God." Can you say amen? Amen. Father, we thank you that you are God. We thank you for all that you desire to do in our lives today. We come now, O Lord, asking that you would feed us until we want no more. Speak to our hearts, speak to us individually, and yet speak to us collectively about your will for our lives, how we can live life today at its best. Living life at its best does not require the best of circumstances, but living life at its best requires us to understand your will and how we can walk in difficult times. How we can stand when we've done all to stand. Now, Lord, bless us to know that you have desired that we might have life and have it more abundantly. You came to bless us. You came to give us a surge and a surplus to life and living. And we desire your will, Lord. For me to live is Christ and me to die is gain. But I want to live, oh God, to your glory and do that which is pleasing in your eyesight. Strengthen us all because we all need strength. Straighten us all because we all need straightening. And then guide us all because we need you to show us the way. Now we thank you today. Cleanse and wash that your word may clearly be heard. Our hearts may clearly be convicted. In Jesus' name, come on, shout amen. Amen. I want to talk about getting fit for success. Getting fit for success. Some of us are just out of shape. Spiritually, can you say amen? In a society of entitlement where people feel that most things should be handed to them, and others feel that life has treated them unfairly or has treated them poorly, they've gotten a bad shake out of life. In the middle of those who accept the challenge that if I am to get anything out of life, I've got to get the most out of me. All of us can admit that the person who needs to be whooped into shape the most is ourselves. We've got to get our minds into shape. We've got to get our spirits into shape. We got to get our bodies into shape. We've got to get our lives into shape. And keeping them into shape is a matter of constant discipline. It's a matter of answering the alarm every day. Have I got a witness here? It is to go to the workout room and apply all of the mantras of life. Are you with me here? No pain, no gain. If you can believe it, you can achieve it. It's nothing to it but to do it. Now, you not only should work harder, but you've got to work smarter. Have I got somebody? But no one informed us that this is an everyday grind. You can't really take time off, because if you take time off, you're going to get out of shape. Are you with me here? It only takes a minute. For us to get out of shape or get out of our routine. 1 week of missing a workout can lead to a whole year of not working out. We've got to keep our hands to the discipline plow. Our children want to become rappers and entertainers, not understanding how much work that it would take for them to become a rapper or for them to become an entertainer. On the other side, our children are disengaged in church, tweeting and texting and talking and doing all kinds of things, not understanding God's plan and purpose for their lives. They think they ought to come to church to sit, and sometimes they think they can just take off on Sunday and send us to church. Come on, say amen. But they've got to understand that commitment comes with all of this. Are you with me here? What underscores all of what we want to accomplish and all of what we desire to do, what is that one missing link? It is the commitment it takes to get there and to be ready for the challenges that meet our lives every day. But this attitude is nothing new in biblical history, because when we look at this passage, all of us want to get the best out of life. And there are three men that approach Jesus Christ, and they are trying to get the best out of life. Have I got somebody? Now notice, if you will, this passage is not giving us the way of salvation. This passage is not talking about what must I do to be saved. This passage does not talk about how can I have eternal life. Rather, this is what is required of men, required of you, if we're going to be followers, disciples, learners of Jesus Christ. It really tells us what is required for us to be successful in life, or what is required for us to be successful, period. We've got to understand that there are some standards, that there are some requirements about life if we're going to get the best out of it. Are you with me here? And so Jesus begins to explain to these three applicants of how to get the best out of life, how to live your life at its best. The first applicant steps up and asks Jesus, what does it really take to follow you? And then at verse 57 and 58, Jesus begins to explain that. He says, you must understand the cost of your commitment. Touch your neighbor and say, there's a cost to this. We used to sing songs that back in the day about what it meant to follow Jesus. Have I got somebody? Some of y'all remember some of these songs. Let me take you down memory lane for a minute. We used to sing songs that let us know that if you came to Jesus Christ, it was a cost to be paid. Have I got somebody? Here is one that I love. Some folk would rather have houses and lands. Some folk choose silver and gold. These things they treasure and forget about their souls. But I've decided to make Jesus my choice. The road is rough. The going gets tough. The hills are hard to climb. I started out a long time ago, and there is no doubt in my mind. I've decided to make Jesus my choice. Do you remember that? How about do you remember this one? I once was alone and idle. I was a sinner too. I heard a voice from heaven saying, there is work to do. I took my master's hand. I joined the Christian band. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Here's the reframe. I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. I promised him that I would serve him till I die. I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. That's what my mother used to sing. She would always tell me about serving the Lord. It would go like this. Just keep working every day. Whatever is right, God said he'll pay. Serve the Lord, it will all. Oh, I know it will pay off after a while. I've got to keep on working. Yes, I have. Because I want to get my starry crown. I know my way will get brighter, even though my friends sometimes let me down. And oh, what a time it will be when my Savior face I see. Serving the Lord, it all will pay off after a while. Have I got somebody? Here's one that talks about our commitment or the price of commitment. And we all know this one. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. All to Jesus I surrender humbly. At his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus. Take me now. Here's the reframe. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Have I got somebody? Well, the first applicant seemed to be saying to Jesus, I surrender all, because other translations have translated his words like this. I will always follow you no matter where you go. And many of us have said that to Christ. Lord, I'm going to follow you no matter what it takes. I don't care how hard it gets. I don't care how tough it gets. I'm going to follow you. It was even apparent to us that in the days that we would accept Jesus Christ, back in those days, our farm would dry up like a raisin in the sun. You came to Jesus, you had to give up something. I'm talking to some old saints now. You couldn't come to Jesus and still be prancing and dancing in the world. Oh, come on, talk to me. Coming to Jesus means you had to turn your life around. Have I got somebody? How many know that a commitment isn't a commitment until you paid the cost? I wish I had somebody. A testimony ain't a testimony until you pass the test. Too many of us are confessing one thing and actually doing something else. We got a profession, but we don't have no practice behind it. If we had to qualify our Christianity, most of us would come up with a zero. The first applicant, he's impetuous. He's impulsive. And it appears that he's naively exuberant about following Jesus. I'll follow Jesus. I'll follow Jesus wherever he goes. He must have been persuaded by the crowd. But there is a difference between the crowd and the committed. The crowd comes to church on Sunday. The committed comes to church on Monday.
The crowd comes to church on Sunday to get their praise on. The committed will show up on Tuesday morning to study at the feet of Jesus. The crowd comes to church just to pass through to see who's here, but the committed will be here on Wednesday night. Are you with me here? I'm sure he had various reasons for following Jesus. And we all do. We love to sing God's praises. We love to be in the presence of God. We are moved by the teachings of Jesus and his wisdom. He was mesmerized by all the miracles that Christ was performing. And I'm sure he appreciated the goodness of God. I mean, who would not appreciate somebody who could feed you with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread? I mean, you can get in the Luby's line. I mean, it was over 5,000 in that line. Come on. I mean, they had to appreciate him. And why not? Jesus is the perfect model of everything he says. I mean, he's not asking us to do something he's not willing to do. Jesus told a man, you got to count the cost. You can't profess one thing and not practice it. Have I got somebody? But today, anybody can say they're a Christian. Anybody can say they go to church, but that's not the point with Jesus. Jesus wants to know, are you following him? Are you with me here? The Bible says he was the Son of Man, which means that Jesus is the ideal servant. Following him, he shows us the right way how to walk with God. Have I got somebody? There it is, an exchange between the first applicant and Jesus, and they both are using the same terms. He uses the term follow the Lord in 61. God uses that same term. But don't you know some folk can use church jargon and don't know what they're talking about? Everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. I wish I had somebody. But Jesus was trying to tell him there is a real difference when you talk about following me and becoming a disciple of me. You really want to hang out with me? You really want to accompany me? You really want to join me? You really want to go down the road with me? And the man was saying, yes, I want to go with you. But Jesus says, you can go down the road with me, but I need to show you what down the road looks like. So there he is. He presents to him. Or he tests his student to see if he's really committed to paying the cost. Jesus' statement to him makes an enormous demand upon him because he wants to know, will you follow him anywhere? For the purpose of testing him and requiring his worthiness. So Jesus put it to him like this. Foxes have holes. Birds of the air have nests. But I've got to remind you that the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. I know you want to hang out with this entourage. Listen, we're not going to no 4-star hotels. Matter of fact, we can't even afford a motel. We might be sleeping on the side of the road. There is no luxury going with Jesus. You've got to decide that you're going to soldier up and follow me. It's going to get rough. It's going to get tough. Here are all of the costs. I'm going to lay it out and put it on the table. Do you still want to follow me? Jesus response was to this person to find out if he truly desired to follow the Lord. That he had to give up some what we consider common necessities if we're going to follow Jesus Christ. This man, as well as us, needs to understand the cost that's attached to following Jesus if we plan on going down the road with him. Yeah. While most of God's creatures have a place to eat, sleep, and live, you've got to remember that Jesus had nowhere to lay his head. And we must not be sidetracked by worldly securities or chasing worldly comfort. Following Jesus is far more valuable than anything the world has to offer. But some of us are trying to chase worldly things. Christ comes first. We are living too close to the world, and that's why we see Jesus every now and then. God says you got to make me a priority, and that's the cost you got to pay if you want to follow me. There's a difference. There is a difference between dreams and fulfilled dreams. whole lot of us are dreaming about things. But there's a difference between your dream and fulfilling your dream. Many of us are sitting up in here right now thinking about our dream house, thinking about our dream car, thinking about our dream wardrobe, the shoes we like to wear, dream vacation. You know, we thinking about our dream iPod, our iPhone. Some of us went up to the shop to get the iPhone, but we didn't get it. And see, there's a common denominator when you shop for cars and shop for houses and shop for watches and shop for iPhones and iPads. The common denominator is that at the finality of everything, you got to ask that salesman, what does it cost? And if you really want it, you got to pay the price. If you really want to follow Jesus, you got to pay. I wish I had somebody. You got to be willing to say, God, I'll go where you go. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll do what you want me to do. I'll put aside some common comforts and necessities in order to follow you. Some of us want it easy, but God says it ain't easy. Here comes the second applicant. Wanted to know what, you know, what is required to follow Jesus. So he gets in line. And Jesus says to him in verse 59 through 60, you must know the importance of your call. Touch your neighbor, you being called. Jesus looked at this man. He saw something special in this man. And so when Jesus told him, listen, you need to go and preach, the man hesitated, but Jesus stayed with him because he saw something special in him. This man had been called by Jesus Christ to follow him. What an honor it is to be called by God. Have I got somebody? Let me give you some good news. All of us have been called by God. I understand you live a raggedy life. Some of us just got out of TDC. Some of us did some things last night. But all of us have been called by God. If you are saved, you've been called by God. There is a call to duty. I understand you made mistakes. I understand you ain't the best person on the planet, but you've been called if you've been covered in the blood. Touch your neighbor and say, if you've been covered, you've been called. There is a call to duty, and nothing should distract you from performing your duty. Paul says in 2 Timothy 2, 3 through 4, you therefore must endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself in the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. You've been called. We look at this call, there are two important things that we ought to know about this call. Number one, every person is extremely valuable to God. There's nobody in here that's not important. You need to understand that you have value to God. But secondly, every person who is called by Christ must report to duty. You've got to report to duty. And when they had this exchange, you can see Jesus' response to this man. And what we can gather from Jesus' response is this. There is a sense of urgency connected to your duty. God is not going to let you off the hook for any reason. And it's obvious this man gave a good reason. But God did not let him off the hook. There is a sense of urgency about the business God has called us to do. And he told them, go and preach the gospel. Here's what we need to understand. When Christ calls us, he demands first loyalty. All of us got to be loyal to God. Who told you you could just pass by the church every now and then? Who told you you don't have to stay on your knees and stay before the presence of God? Who told you you can miss Bible study at your whim whenever you feel like it? You are called to be loyal to God. Not only are you called to be loyal, But he says you got to respond immediately. And there are some things that interfere with our call of duty. He says, let me go and bury my father. Seems like a great response. Seems like an honest thing to do. But there are two trends of thought that go right here. He wanted to go and bury his father. Everybody would probably say, let him go. Bury his dad. Well, two ideas emerge here. One is that there are two traditions that exist. The first one was when a Jewish person died, they buried him immediately. But after the body decayed, there was a second burial. And that person was placed in a walled tomb, or his bones were placed in a walled tomb. And then secondly, the idea is he was saying to Jesus, let me wait until my father die, collect the inheritance, and then I'll follow you. The first tradition would take probably a year. The second was an indefinite time. Jesus says, you got your priorities all mixed up. When it comes to following Jesus, he comes first. Let the dead, let me help you out, let the spiritually dead bury their own dead. You've got some real concerns. You need to go and preach the kingdom of God. People are dying spiritually every day. I'm not trying to get you to put them in the ground. I'm trying to get you to resurrect them to spiritual life. Preach the gospel. Nothing should come before Christ. Nothing is higher than doing God's bidding. Not financial security or family approval. We got to follow Christ. When Christ calls us to be disciples, the one thing that can come in between discipleship is human affection. But human affection should take second place to the will of God. We are called to do God's duty. People take oaths of service all the time. Soldiers take an oath to protect the Constitution. Policemen take oath to protect and serve. Teachers take oaths of education to educate our children. Congressmen, they take oath to take care of their constituents. Doctors, a hippo oath. But believers take an oath to preach and proclaim the gospel. We don't have time for anything else. Raise your right hand and repeat after me. I will go and preach the gospel, and I will let nothing interfere with that. When I leave church, it won't be about gossip. It'll be about the gospel. I wish I had somebody. We don't have time for nothing else. We need to go and preach the gospel. Nothing comes before preaching God's gospel. Number three. You got to accept what God is telling you. Number three. Here's a third applicant. He walks up. Makes his application. Jesus says, you must accept the challenge. Watch this now. Of commitment. The challenge. Because commitment is a challenge. Challenge of what? Commitment. The third applicant volunteers like the first one, but couldn't follow Jesus because he was looking back. He wanted a furlough to go and bid his loved ones farewell. But Jesus knew, although this sounds innocent, Jesus knew this was a half-hearted follower of Jesus Christ. He did not understand the challenge to commit. And Jesus immediately illuminates this kind of commitment that he was calling for. He wanted total commitment and not a half-hearted commitment. Our problem is we allow too many people to be half-hearted committed to Christ, and they think they're following Christ. You may have been saved, but you're not truly living a sanctified life if you're doing what you want to do. I wish I had somebody. It seems like it was innocent. There was nothing wrong with a loving farewell. But if that loving farewell gets in the way of obedience, it becomes sin. Family should be first, the first attachment after the attachment of Christ. Christ comes first. You know, isn't it strange that when you get saved, all of a sudden your family want to tell you how you ought to function in church? And most of them are not even in church. I wish I had a witness. They're telling you, you ain't got to do all that. Why you got to go every Sunday? Why you got to go every Wednesday night? Why you got to tithe your money to the Lord? Why you got to do this and why you got to do that? First, you ought to let them know you haven't been covered in the blood yet. So you don't know the cost, but I've been washed in the blood of Jesus. Christ has brought me out. And since Christ has brought me out, I got a duty to serve the Lord. If it had not been for God on my side, I still would be messed up. I still would be doing the things I used to do. The difference you see now was a difference that Jesus made. I've decided to serve him. Therefore, what Christ was telling him, you can't take advice from your family about serving as a sacrifice. You got to keep your eyes fixed on me. No looking. Too many of us are. I wish I had somebody. He was obviously distracted. Look at the verse. You notice the word but. And first, after Christ's command, when Jesus tells us to do something, there's no but. There's no first. God comes first. But he wanted to put his family affairs first, his business first, his employment first, his finances first. Does that sound like many Christians in the church? Nobody first. Christ comes first. Looking back, you ever plowed in the country? Some of us don't know what it means to plow. Young people don't know nothing about plowing. But when you look back, that was a sign of being greatly distracted. And believers can become distracted by family, by friends, by finances, and flirtation with the world. Most of us tell Jesus, I'll catch up with you later. When a concert come to town? Looking back. When games come to town, looking back. Got something to do on Saturday night, looking back. Everything takes precedence over following Christ first. Looking back, he illustrates really what's called a crooked plow. Shows how we disqualify our service by giving him half-hearted service. Is the idea of a man looking back and plowing a crooked road. Just looking back. When you look back, the first thing you do, you plow a crooked road. And listen, the road and the plower is the same. If your road is crooked, you crooked. If your row is straight, you straight. Have I got somebody? We just like what we do. He says, not only is it a crooked row, but the idea means to plow an inconsistent field. That what God has given you never reaches maturation, and your work is never consistent because you're always. Everything is always pulling you out of. You just looking back. We don't see this Sunday for some festival over here, some concert over here, some game over here, some going on over there. You just looking. Looking back plows in the spirit of lacking commitment. He may turn away at any time. Leaving the job undone. You're supposed to sing in a choir, but we can't count on you. Supposed to usher on the usher board, we can't count on you. supposed to be a part of a stewardship team, but we can't count on you. You're inconsistent. You're supposed to teach, but you're not there. Why? You got something that's catching your eye every Sunday, every Saturday night. Church does not become a priority because you're looking. Preach, Pastor West. Plowing a crooked road. It means to plow, but allow distractions to come into your life. Have I got somebody? And your distractions affect a proper crop. Anybody in the room plow? You don't just plow up the ground. You plow things under the ground. So you can plow for a crop, or you can plow after the crop. You can plow up potatoes. Our problem is, if we keep looking back, there are things that will go to waste in our lives. Because we always... Yeah, I really don't get no enjoyment out of church. Spirit don't seem to be there. I come and nobody really know me. You're not getting full productivity out because you don't want to confess. You're looking. I know you're convicted. That's why I'm preaching this. Because I'm trying to tell you, you can't treat Jesus any kind of way. You like Tony Braxton, 7 more days. Huh? Not a word from you. You feel like you can just run up and in and out of here. Like, I'm supposed to keep this door open for you. You know how like some man abuse a woman. He's going to keep running in and up and out of here. Uh-huh. One day you're going to find out I got somebody else. Huh? Because you treat Jesus any kind of way. And think God's supposed to bless everything you do. Who told you that? Who told you that? Who lied to you like that? The Bible say you ain't even fit. That's what the Bible say now. See, really it's supposed to be what we call in the Bible, hermeneutically correct, the judgment of God. You can't serve God half-hearted. Listen and serve him proper, which means that God's divine judgment is already in place. If you try to serve God half-hearted, you'll never get out of the service what you want to get out because God will not allow it. That deep in it. You always wonder why your joy and all that. Why your peace seemed to be fleeing. Why your love seemed to be lacking. Because God ain't taking no coward soldiers. You keep. Watch this. Let's do Bible. Just Bible. Two examples of looking. Bang. Lot's wife. You ask yourself, what in the world? Was she looking back? Huh? You know what she was looking back at, don't you? You know, most people are biblically ignorant. She was looking back at Sodom and what was she looking back at? And listen to this. God told her not. Warned her. Told her, you look back, you're going to. Huh? You know what that's really called? That's called in the Bible, turning your nose up at God. You think you can do something he told you and it's going to be all right. So she decided, are you with me? To look back. And the Bible says when she looked back, her whole life wasted away. You know why? Some people are looking back right now and your whole life is wasting away. Man, I used to have a good job. But the job you got now, you got attitudes on. Oh, come on. You need to stop looking back. My relationship. relationship was good, but now, you know, you ain't in that relationship. They done left you. You left them. You need to stop looking back. I used to have a great figure. You need to get back out on that track. Stop. You're wasting your life away. I used to be sharp. I used to have things together. Things would come to me right away. Get back into your books. Get back on your grind. Stop. Looking back. You got to look forward. You can waste your life. But the second one is, you can mess up your service. Elisha. Elisha. The mantle of Elijah, mantle, his cloak fell on it while he was plowing, trying to help some people. He knew that was God's transitioning of one prophet to another. He simply made an honest request. Let me go and kiss my parents. Elijah told him, no, I have nothing to do with you. And you would say, well, that seems harsh, because God's order or commandment does not come second to none. Wish I had somebody. That's why some of our lives messed up, because we codependent on the wrong folk. We got too much sympathy for the wrong individuals. They don't mean us no good. They ain't gonna do us no good. But we're always helping them out, and they never turn around to help themselves out. Oh, I'm on it. Sorry, lazy, no good. Always calling on you. And when you don't do it, they cop an attitude. Won't answer the phone when you call them. Can't text you back. Won't come and see you even though they know you're down. You can't make it to church trying to help them out. Messing your service up for the Lord. When Elijah told him, I don't have nothing to do with you, he slaughtered his 12 oxen. You know why he slaughtered them? There was no going back. When God calls you to service, there's no going back. God will cover your family if you serve him properly. I'm going to say that again. God will cover your family if you serve him properly. That same person that's tearing the whole family up, God will get them in church and save them and dip them in the blood of Jesus and turn their life around, and they will become a blessing to the family. But you got to serve the Lord. Help me, Jesus. Stop. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Listen. Listen, listen. Listen, listen to me. Listen, listen, listen. All of us have been looking back. All of us get caught up. All of us get in the rat race of life. All of us have responsibility. The job calls us out all the time. I am not telling you to miss work. I'm telling you, you want to keep Christ first. God cares about taking care of you, and God cares about your family. And you ought to know he cares enough that you can trust him with placing him first in your life. But if you really examine how you've been acting, how you've been going, he is not really first. Too many things come in front of him, which means you're valuing too many things more than Jesus. You're willing to drive 100 miles to catch the game, but can't drive 10 miles to come to Bible study. Listen to me, listen to me. Nothing should interfere with your relationship with Jesus Christ. And there are some important priorities in your life, but you got your priorities straight. Christ comes first, and not that they should be neglected. I'm trying to talk to you. There are things that are going to challenge your commitment. They are trying to distract you from serving Christ fully and you getting the highest blessings from a relationship that's already in place, that he has already died for. You've already accepted him as your Savior and Lord. I'm just asking you to live it out. What you've already said, you want to live out. You say, Pastor, I want to put Christ first in my action and in my practice, right where you are, without hesitation. The Holy Spirit has already convicted you. You stand. Come on. I'm praying right after this. There's no begging. The Holy Spirit has already spoke. All of us ought to be obedient. There's no begging. The Holy Spirit has spoke. You just need to be obedient. Lord, I need to put you first. That's all you need to do. It's just obey. Let him massage your heart. Let him redirect your priorities. Let him remove the things that interfere in your life that try to distract you. Listen, make the commitment right now as we go into prayer. Come on. Make the commitment as we go into prayer. Because we're finna go into prayer. Come on. Many more are so convicted. God has dealt with you. God's not angry with you. I'm not angry with you. He's been dealing with you. You're under conviction. If you're under conviction, surrender to the Spirit. Not to people. Not to who's looking. Because folk are looking. And they need to be standing. Come on. Let's pray. Touch somebody. The Spirit is so speaking. Don't rebel. Don't be stiff-necked. He's speaking.
I never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over all you brought me through, I can see that you are the one I held on to, and I never,
never would have made it.
Oh, I never could have made it.
I'm not afraid to
Somebody just need to testify to somebody next to him. Tell him, I'm stronger. I'm wiser. I'm better. Much better. When I look back over what he brought me through, I realize I made it because I had you to hold on to. Now I'm stronger. Now I'm wiser. I'm better. So much better. I made it. Is there anybody in this house other than me that could declare you made it? Tell your neighbor, never would have made it.
Never would have made it.
Tell them, never could have made it.
Never could have made it without you.
Oh, I wish I had some help here. I wish I had just two or three people that would just declare it. Never would have never could have made it.
Never could have made it without.
I just love to encourage myself. Sometimes I just look in the mirror and say, I'm stronger. I'm wise. I am better. So much better when I look back over what he brought me through. I realize I made it because I had you to hold on to. But I never would have made it. I never could have made it without. Yeah, 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 Lord. Oh, good God Almighty, never would have made it.
Never would have made it.
Never could have made it.
Never could have made it without you.
Sing it one more time. All I need is just one more time. Everybody say with me.